A little while back, I did a couple of videos on in-memory databases. So the feature we've got now in Entity Framework Core that allows us to use this in-memory database to do mocking for unit testing rather than having to write our own mock storage in-memory or using a full-blown database. And one of the questions I got from one of my subscribers, a very interesting question, was, is there any other circumstance that you might want to use an in-memory database? Would you ever want to use it in actual production code? And the simple answer is no, and I'll explain why that is for various reasons. The first thing we've got to ask ourselves is, well, if we're going to use an in-memory database, what is it an alternative to? And the key thing that it's not an alternative to is a regular database, SQL Server or whatever database you may be using, because the key feature, obviously enough, of a database is it stores data persistently. It stores data beyond the lifetime of any program that may be manipulating that data. And that's therefore what you've got to look for in terms of alternatives. So alternatives to SQL Server might be other relational databases like Oracle, or might be non-relational databases like Mongo, or might even be file storage systems. But they've got that key feature of permanent storage. When we're looking at in-memory databases, what we might be comparing it with is other ways of storing data in memory, which is to say using lists and arrays and other collections like that. So what I've got here is a program which will just compare the same sort of functionality implemented using an in-memory database or using collections. So just like we saw before, I've set up a repository interface, and it's a repository that gives us access to a couple of entity types. We've got an author, where we've just got the ID, the name, and a collection of books. And then we've got a book, which has an ID and a title, and then a reference back to the author. And then also, you'll notice there, somewhat redundantly, we also have the author name. Now, you wouldn't normally do that, because you could always just go to the author reference and look up their name, but I've put that in for a specific reason that we'll see later on. I then implement that interface in two ways, just using collections. So there we've got the iRepository implemented with a couple of lists. So that's the traditional way of doing things in memory. And then we've got similar implementation, but using a library context, and that library context is configured to use our in-memory database. So this is what we're suggesting might be an alternative way of manipulating data in memory. And then what we've got to do is see, well, can it do anything better than, or even as well as, what we have in our collections, which is the traditional way of doing things. So if we take a look in our program, what we can see here is we've got a populate function, and all that does is creates a number of authors and a number of books. And then we've got a couple of other ways of manipulating them, like we're going to count a number of books that meet a certain criteria in a couple of ways. We've got one that does it by references, one that does it by a join. And let's consider the things that we saw when we were looking at unit testing that an in-memory database does that a collection does not do. The first thing that it does is that it actually automatically populates IDs. So you'll notice on the author and on the book, I haven't given them an ID value. And if this repository were set up as the in-memory database repository, then as soon as we do the save changes, then our author and our book would automatically be given IDs. But if we do it just with lists, we've either got to provide our own way of implementing those IDs, or actually better still, forget about IDs altogether. IDs are very much a database thing, not an in-memory thing. IDs are what are known as surrogates, surrogate identities. Because when we're dealing with data in a program, the identity, the thing that uniquely tells us we've got one author rather than another author, is the memory address at which that author object is located. We don't need IDs when we're doing OO programming in memory. We only need them when we're taking it out of the program and putting it into the database. So it's not something you need unless you're doing unit testing and trying to mimic the behavior of the database. And in fact, even if you did get an in-memory database to create IDs, they would be different IDs from the ones that were ultimately created when you wrote the data back to the real database. So what would be the point? So that's the first thing that an in-memory database will do, And it's of no benefit at all if we're only operating in memory. The second thing that an in-memory database does is it hooks up reciprocal relationships. So remember we had here that our author has a collection of books and our book is for a particular author. And that is something that actually we don't get automatically if we're dealing in memory. So if we go back here, we can see that if I were using the in-memory database, then as soon as I did save changes, having put the book in the collection of authors, the save changes would set up the author reference in the book. Whereas if I'm doing this programmatically, then I've got to put that line of code in for myself. So that is something that the in-memory database does for us, but it's not something that's particularly difficult for us to do for ourselves. And also it's something we try to avoid when we're writing programs because we've learned from experience that it's easier just to have one-way relationships. Then the third thing that in-memory databases do, if you remember from the earlier videos, is they imitate the behavior that requires us to get our eager loading correct. So eager loading, the way that we decide when we pull one object out of the database and into memory, what other objects should follow it. So if we load an author, should we also load the author's books? Now that's very important when you're doing unit testing, but it's actually effectively a limitation being put on us by the in-memory database. Because when we've got data in memory, the concept of eager loading or lazy loading or anything like that just goes away. It's just there in memory. So it's a feature that's actually designed in a way to make in-memory databases more difficult to use so that they behave like actual databases. So not a benefit and therefore not something we can have for comparison. So of the three functional things they do, the IDs and the eager loading are just something you wouldn't want at all. And those reciprocal references are something that's pretty easy to fix. But those are all functional questions. Probably the big question that people are going to have to ask is, well, what about performance? Could there be any performance benefit in using an in-memory database? And that is something else I've got to show you here. So what we've got here is I've actually hooked up this little timestamp function that just wraps up a function that we call. So here we're doing populate. So it's going to be 1,000 authors, each with 1,000 books. So that's going to be 1,000,000 books, 1,000 authors. And it will just subtract the time at the start of that operation, the time at the end of it, and show us how long it took. I'm then also going to do this count by reference. So what I do here is select all the authors whose name length is less than 10. So basically, author names I've generated, it'll just be author underscore and then 0 through to 999. So if the author name length is less than 10, that will basically be only the ones up to a value of 99, not anything above that. Just a way of filtering it down to get a subset of the authors. And then I'm going to, from those authors, I'm going to select all the books whose name, and the books go similarly, their names, book underscore and then a number, whose name is divisible by 3. So for all of the authors under 100, we're going to have a book that's divisible by 3, just a way to do some kind of filtration, and then we're going to see how many books we get matched on that. And that's really an object-oriented way of doing things. We select the authors, then we, from the authors, get the books. But I've also done exactly the same thing using a link join, because if we're considering performance, whilst you might expect this sort of thing that goes through looping through collections to be good with data structures like lists, if we're doing a join, joins are what databases do, so maybe an in-memory database will do that quicker. And so I'm doing a join, and that's why I had that author name. So actually I am joining books to authors on the basis of author name rather than selecting them just by looking at the collection. And then we again do the book count. So numerically, these two should give us exactly the same number of books. We're still looking for authors with a name whose length is less than 10 and books whose number is divisible by 3. So that should be perfectly fine. So we time the population, we time the counting by reference, we time the counting by join. And we'll start out by doing that with our repository to be the collections repository. So this is the one dealing with lists. Let's, just to be fair, switch that to a release build and then build that and run that up. And we can see that it was pretty fast, so it populated in half a second. It did the books by reference in 38 milliseconds. And the one with the join, which I think you'd expect because we're joining over a string, took a little bit longer, but those are the values we have. So let's get rid of the collections repository using lists and replace it by the one that uses the in-memory database, and then do exactly the same thing. But here I am, in fact, going to speed up time because it's going to take so long. So there we can see it took 37 seconds compared to half a second to load the data. That is an absolute killer. It took 7 seconds to do the count by reference. And even the join, which is the thing you think it should be good at, took 137 milliseconds compared with 112. So performance-wise, we definitely want to avoid in-memory databases. When we're doing unit testing, we don't really care too much about performance because we tend to be dealing with very small amounts of data, just enough for the tests. Whereas here, we can see once we get to large amounts of data, it can be rather inefficient. One last argument you might have in favour of an in-memory database is, well, can't it do the very thing that databases are supposed to do, which is accept SQL queries? Well, I'd argue against that anyway, because the whole point of link is that we don't need to write SQL queries. We can write link queries. They will manipulate in-memory data in one way, and they'll be converted into SQL to manipulate the actual database. But maybe if you've got a lot of expertise in SQL, not a lot in link, you might want to do that. So what we might be able to do, we can see that's going to be completely impossible to do on a list, but let's go to something like our in-memory repository. And on here, let's just put in a method. We're going to call this public, and then we'll say book, and we'll call this get by SQL. So I'm not putting it in the interface because there's just no way it's going to work with the collections repository. And then what we can do something like say return, and then our DB set of books that are actually storing those in actually has a method called from SQL. In fact, there's a couple of them, but we're going to do from SQL raw. So what I could do with that would be actually put in an SQL query. So let's do select star from books where, and then let's just have title equals, and then remember the way we named our books, so we'll just call this book 20, say, and then dot, that should only select one of them, so we can just get the one book out doing a single. So this is something you just certainly could not do. You can manipulate a list with link, but you can't directly manipulate it with SQL. So that's looking good. Then if we go back to our program, let's say we're not doing this through the repository. So what we'll have to do here is actually, let's just do it like this, just say var in-mem. So do it like that. And then we can say something like in-mem dot get by SQL. So we'll say book B equals, then we don't need to do anything else. And let's run that. And we get an unhandled exception, and it's a not implemented exception, simply because although the DB set has to make available the from SQL raw for when we're using this through the real database, the in-memory database does not understand SQL at all. So we get a runtime error, so that potential benefit has disappeared. So that was really it, just to show you that there are no significant benefits from using in-memory databases, except when we want to do unit testing, where we are trying to mimic as closely as possible the behavior of an actual database. But when we're trying to do in-memory manipulation, we don't want to mimic a database, we want to actually have in-memory collections. One little caveat on that, I say there is no benefit. I can't find one. I've looked around. I can't see anyone else who finds one. But if you can think of a situation where there really would be a benefit, do let me know. Pop it in the comment. Do also subscribe, and I'll see you next time.